بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا وطيبا مباركا فيه، وصلوات الله وسلامه على نبينا الأمين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين، وعلى من تمسك بسنته بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. ثم أما بعد، فإن خير الكلام كلام الله، وخير الهدى هدى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم تسليما كثيرا، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. First, we want to begin, Ikhwani, when we talk about this subject matter that has been chosen and given to me, I just wanted to acknowledge that the one who came up with this title, or the people who came up with the title, we ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to put in his mawazin of hasanat. Sometimes people invite you to give lectures at their masjid, and they have an idea in their head about a particular thing, but a lot of times, people come up with ideas. The idea is not necessarily relevant. It's not necessarily beneficial. So a lot of times I tell people, I'm not doing that talk. The talk is corny. This thing you came up with is corny. But in this case, I think the people who came up with this particular title, it's an important title and it's a beneficial one and it's relevant. And it's relevant from a number of angles. The first of which is the fact that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he informed us that all of the prophets and all of the messengers, they came and they informed their people of what their people needed to know from the good as well as from the bad. Not just the good, but as well as the bad. Those things that will harm the people. So the Muslim is going to exist, and he has in the Quran and he has in the authentic Sunnah a lot of instructions, prohibitions, telling him, encouraging him, warning him, this is good, so do that, and this is bad, so avoid this. The authentic hadith that was collected by Imam Muslim, Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, may Allah be pleased with both of them, he said that the Nabi says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and mentioned his point, إِنَّهُ لَمْ يَكُنْ نَبِيٌ إِلَّا كَانَ حَقًّا عَلَيْهِ أَنْ يَدُلُّ أُمَّتَهُ عَلَى خَيْرِ مَا يَعْلَمُهُ لَهُمْ وَيُنذِرُهُمْ شَرَّ مَا يَعْلَمُهُ لَهُمْ. There was never a prophet, a messenger, a Nabi who came before me, except it was his obligation, it was his job, his duty, to tell his people about all of the good that he knew that they needed to know, and all of the evil that he knew that they needed to know. So the prophets and the messengers, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhim, they just didn't come with do good, do good, do good. They also came with the antithesis of that, the other message. Watch out for this and watch out for that. So we see the hadith Ra'i of Hudhayf ibn al-Yaman, may Allah be pleased with both of them. In his famous athar, كَانَ النَّاسُ يَسْأَلُونَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ عَنَ الْخَيْرِ وَكُنْتُ أَسْأَلُهُ عَلَى الشَّرْ مَخَافَةً يُدْرِكَنِ. The other companions, they used to ask the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about the good things. And I, on the other hand, I used to ask him about the evil. And I would ask him about those evil things so that I can avoid them, so that I won't fall into it. So when the person came up with this topic, reasons for weakness, it is a topic that we need to know. There are many things that we've been told in the Quran and the Sunnah. We won't be able to deal with all of them, get through all of them today, but there are many things that cause weaknesses in the Ummah, the whole Ummah. To the point where the enemies of Islam, if they want to go into a Muslim country and they want to take all of their resources, kill the people, rape the people, do what they want to do, Muslims ain't going to do nothing about it. We're just going to look back and see how it goes. So there are a lot of things the Prophet mentioned about that, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Weaknesses, things that happen that will cause your community to be weak. this community to be weak, cause the individual to be weak, cause the family to be weak. Many things, many things. Dealing with some of the Muslims who are in prison, there is a community inside of the prison. There's a community there. And although they are locked up and their freedom has been taken away from them, nonetheless, there's an Islamic Muslim community inside of the prison. Certain things that they do, certain things that they don't do, it weakens them even more. Many things. So we, inshallah, azwajal, are going to touch upon all of these issues, whether it is community-wise, communal, whether it's on an individual basis, whether it's this community right here, the whole Ummah internationally, whatever the case may be. And we ask Allah azwajal for his at-tawfiq. Another issue that I got to bring to your attention, ikhwani, about this concept of being aware of the good and the bad, and getting fiqh and understanding and comprehension as a Muslim of the good and the bad, is what the ulama of Islam did. And the ulama of Islam, they always took the responsibility of advising the community. So what did they do? They wrote books just talking about the bad, like those books of the Kaba'ir. Most beneficial one, Allah knows best, Kitab al-Kaba'ir by Imam al-Dhahabi. That is a book that's been translated into English in almost every language, I would think, that all of us will be doing ourselves a favor and our families as well, just going through that book, just reading it. Hadith, hadith, chapter, chapter. Especially right now, in this country where our children are growing up and they're having this issue, can a man use the toilet of a woman, and can a woman use the toilet of the man? And they're discussing that right now, using the same toilets. Some of our children are being faced with challenges where their sexuality and their sexual orientation is up in the air. Just heard a word for the first time today. Non-binary. Pakistani Muslim girl was talking about this when she asked Obama a question. She said, I'm non-binary. I said, what is that non-binary? It's a new category now with the LGBT people. And I still don't understand it. So if a person wants to use the woman's toilet and it's a man, can you stop them? Or is that their right? So nonsense. So some of our children are growing up right now. Some of the younger Muslims are growing up right now where they are actually under the impression, like the Quliyam Foundation and these people will have you to understand and believe, that the ulama of Islam in the past, they used to consider and entertain a Muslim having an orientation other than a man marrying a woman and a woman marrying a man. So we read these books, Kitab al-Kaba'ir by Imam al-Dhahabi. Your children will come to know there's a chapter from the major sins, homosexuality. There's a chapter from the major sins about lesbianism. So don't sleep on those types of basic books. So it's an indication again, where the scholars of Islam, our religion is not just about learn the good, learn the good. Prophet Muhammad was sitting with his companion, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said to the people, Allah, أُحَدِّثُكُمْ بِأَكْبَرِ الْكَبَائِرِ قَالُوا بَلَى يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ قَالَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ الْإِشْرَاقُ بِاللَّهِ وَأُقُوقِ الْوَالِدَيْنِ. He taught the people. He was lying down, reclining. He said, should I not tell you people about the biggest of the sins? The biggest of the sins. They say, yes, Ya Rasulullah, we want to know that big sin. What is it? He said, making shirk with Allah, making shirk. And then he said, and being disrespectful to your parents. And while he was sitting down, he sat up to say a third one. But to show them the seriousness of the third one, he didn't stay reclining. He sat up. And then he told them, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ala wa qawlu zur, aw shahadatu zur. Also giving false testimony as well. Giving false testimony, saying a statement that's false. And he kept repeating, kept repeating, kept repeating. Companion said, he said it so many times that we said, Ya laytuhu sakata. We wish that he would just be quiet, to have rahmah upon him, because he kept saying it, to show them the seriousness of it. So the point here is, just didn't teach them about the Jannah, do this as good as that. He told them about the evil things as well. And one of the things we've been informed of are those things that will cause weakness, weakness in the community and other than that. First thing we want to mention and we want to remind you of, inshallah, and we hope that knowing this gives you more incentive to keep the course and to continue to try to be people of the Sunnah, people on As-Salafiyya, you know, being balanced. Just being balanced and being proud to be people who are a bit different in that. We know that there are a lot of Muslims out there, we know that there are a lot of ideas out there, but we can't be embarrassed or shy to tell the world, hey, we're Muslims, and these are the type of Muslims we are. So if someone were to ask me, Abu Usama, what do you think about a Salafiyya? Although I know there are people in the audience who may not necessarily like a Salafiyya or understand it, I can't run away from the answer. I can't run away from the answer. I have to let the people know in the best way possible to articulate it. As Salafiyya is nothing more than understanding the Quran and the Sunnah the way the companions understood it and practiced it. May Allah be pleased with that. I try my best way not to talk in an aggressive way so that people who don't like the Salafiyya and they don't understand it, when they hear my explanation, they run away. No. I can't be the rough guy that runs them away and makes them fear, nor can I be like the other guy who acquiesces and I don't say the truth. So when the Prophet ﷺ stood up and he said, the third major sin is bearing false witness, qawl zur. If someone asked me, what is Salafiyya? And I didn't say it at that time, and it should be said at that time, that's part of qawl zur, shahadat zur. Gotta tell the truth. But this thing that I'm gonna mention right now, again, I mentioned it first so that it will resonate with you and you'll remember it was the first thing. Being proud, for lack of a better word, of being upon this way of the path of the Sunnah. One of the things that causes weakness, based upon what the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he described himself in his da'wah, in an authentic hadith, he said, بُعِثْتُ بَيْنَ يَدَيِ السَّاعَةِ بِالسَّيْفِ حَتَّى يُعْبُدَ اللَّهُ وَحْدَهُ وَجُعِلَ رِزْقِي تَحْتَ ذِي الرُّمْحِ وَجُعِلَ الذِّلَّةُ وَالصَّغَارُ عَلَى مَنْ خَالَفَ أَمْرِي وَمَنْ تَشَبَّهَ بِقَوْمٍ فَهُوَ مِنْهُمْ. Five different things he's mentioned. He said, I have been sent close to the hour with the sword. So in Al-Islam, the scholar said, the first sign of Yawm al-Qiyamah, you know, Yawm al-Qiyamah has Ashraf, Ashratu Sa'ah, major ones and minor ones, 10 big ones, and many smalls. They said that the first sign of Yawm al-Qiyamah is that Allah sent the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's the first sign. Coming to Bani Adam, telling them, hey, you better get ready. Yawm al-Qiyamah is coming. He said, I've been sent close to Yawm al-Qiyamah with the sword. Meaning what? There's jihad in our religion. You gotta protect your religion. You're gonna always have knuckleheads who they only understand one language. They don't understand a discussion. They don't understand calmness. They're always those people who understand language and the message when they have to be dealt with in that type of way. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in that hadith, I've been sent close to the hour with the sword so that Allah could be worshipped all alone. I wasn't sent with the sword to discriminately shed blood, indiscriminate. I'm just gonna kill people, make foba. I'm just gonna go crazy. Make people hate Islam. I was sent with the sword, showing people, hey, this religion is a balanced religion. You mess with us, you mess with the religion, you're gonna have to deal with it. We're not that, turn the other cheek, give them your, we're not that, we're not on that. But the goal and the objective is for the Tawheed of Allah. So we say, unapologetically, that these people who are right now, as you know, were out there, Boko Haram, Shabab, all of them, Qaeda, Daesh, all of them. That's not their goal, that's not their objective. Number three, he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and my sustenance has been made under the shade of my spear, my rizq. Some of you work, some people on welfare, some people have inherited. The Rasul of Islam, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Khatim of the Anbiya and the Rasul, the Sayyid of Bani Adam, He said, جُعِلَ رِزْقِي تَحْتَ ذِلْ رُمْحِ. My sustenance, I don't go out and work. I don't have a job like that. And I don't take welfare. And I don't take sadaqah. And I don't take zakat. My risk comes under the shade of my spear. And that goes to show, ikhwani, that people want to be politically correct. You only can be politically correct up to a certain point where we can't use the J word. I mean, the Muslims even call it that, the J word. What's the J word, man? What are you talking about? But it's so well known, we know it. No, just talk about jihad in the proper context. Don't be apologetic about our religion, just in the proper context. The Nabi of Islam, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he had 7 swords. The Nabi of Islam, and he had names for each sword. One of the names you're probably well familiar with is the word Dhulfiqar. It's a famous Pakistani Asian name. Dhulfiqar, what do I mean? It means one of the swords of the Prophet. Rasulullah, he had 8 spears. 8 spears. That gives you an idea and an indication. Rasulullah was a warrior, but not a mad, crazy person. He wasn't crazy. I mean, you got to come and look at the rest of the story. But look, don't come and try to pass off that stuff that he was some passive guy person to that degree. Yes, he was the Nabi of Ar-Rahma and all of that. He was all of that. But he was a warrior at the same time. But not what they mean, like some crazy bloodthirsty guy. No, not like that. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He went on to mention in that same hadith, he said, and anyone who goes against my sunnah, he will be put down, he will be low, he will be weak. And then he ended that hadith with the last thing, وَمَنْ تَشَبَّهَ بِقَوْمٍ فَهُوَ مِنْهُمْ. And anyone who resembles a people, he's from those people. What's the wisdom of that last part? Rasulullah is telling us everything about himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's like this, he's like that, his risk is like this, he was sent to give da'wah Allah for a tawheed, all of this. So if you want to be other than those things, I mean other than that, then you'll be along with those people who you choose to be like. So the point here is, very clearly, this hadith goes to show, if a person goes against the sunnah, it's a cause of weakness. If people upon innovation has been introduced, it's a cause of weakness. If a person is practicing innovation, endorsing and helping it is a cause of weakness based upon that prophetic hadith. And a lot can be said about it, a lot can be said, but we have a lot to deal with. So in beginning with that, I want to encourage you, brothers, be proud, be steadfast, be in people on the sunnah. We're living in a time right now you can sit with someone and he's trying to tell the importance of hikmah, and the way he's talking, he's really being apologetic and he's acquiescing, but what he's saying is making sense because the time we're living in is like that. Obama came to this country right now, Obama, and I gotta tell you, it's the truth. Obama's a cool guy. He's cool. He's a cool guy. You look at him, he's extremely articulate. You'll believe him when you listen to him. He hangs out with the hip-hop people. He hangs out with musicians. He hangs out with the actors and the actresses. Whenever you ask him something, he always gives the right answer. He has a lot of things about him when you look at. But as a Muslim, I have to say, hey, by default, he's the president of the United States of America. He's killing more Muslims than anybody else on the face of the earth. So I can't ever forget that. And I can't forget and be tricked. That coolness made me forget what's the reality. So the point here, we're living in a tough time right now. The time things are topsy-turvy. I'm not calling anyone to be rough and tough. I'm against that stuff, and we're going to come to that, inshallah. I'm against that rough and tough stuff, but just as much as I'm against the rough and tough stuff, the other approach is a problem as well. That approach where, I remember 15, 20 years ago, we used to find out, this is the sunnah, that's the sunnah, like putting your feet together and putting your heels together. 20 years later, you'll find those same people were doing that back then. Like, man, I gotta go there. Islam is easy. Islam is easy. The one who does that is the new revert who read that hadith. The newly practicing brother who read that hadith. So it means something to him now. Guy is like 50 years old. Many of us are beyond 50 now. You know, man, ain't gotta do that. We've grown out of that. Number two, the second thing. From what were called weakness is another tremendous hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, very similar to the first one, but it has some differences in it, some things that were mentioned. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, in this authentic hadith, and it's been collected by the Imam Abu Dawood and Ahmed in his Musnad on the authority of Ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Umar, may Allah be pleased with both of them. And he told the condition of the Ummah, إِذَا تَبَايَعْتُمْ بِالْعِينَ وَأَخَذْتُمْ أَذْنَابَ الْبَقَرِ وَرَضِيتُمْ بِالزَّرْعِ وَتَرَكْتُمَ الْجِهَادِ سَلَّطَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكُمْ ظُلًّا لَا يَنْزِعُهَا حَتَّى تَرْجِعُوا إِلَى دِينِكُمْ. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if this community, if you people, if the individual, if you people started to do commerce in riba, and you start to devour riba, become something normal. It's just the way the life is, and that's what we're doing. He didn't mention in the Muslim world or not the Muslim world. He's just mentioning a reality. If you people start dealing in riba, and you start to deal with agriculture, and you start to deal with your animals, you know, that you take care of the cows, taking the tails of the cows, plowing the land, agriculture, meaning making money, the dunya. And if you abandon the jihad, fi sabilillah, you abandon jihad, Allah is going to make you down. Allah is going to put you down. And He's not going to take that condition off of you until you return back to your religion. That is kalam of prophecy from the Mishkat of An-Nubuwa. I can't come and I can't sugarcoat it. That's what it said. That's how it is. So if you look closely in the hadith, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he called al-jihad the deen. He said, all right, if you people become preoccupied with the dunya and it's the most important thing to you, turning to the dunya, trade and all that kind of stuff, and you leave off al-jihad, Allah is going to put you down until you return to your deen. So he described jihad as the deen. It's another example of how we can't do in this time because people don't like it. We can't escape that word. Someone, when he starts to learn this religion, he's starting on his deen, wants to be a student of knowledge. We're going to tell him the very first hadith book that you should start with is the 40 hadith of Imam al-Nawawi. So when you come to the hadith, Dharatu Sanami in the jihad fi sabilillah, the upper peak of this religion is jihad in the cause of Allah. In that basic book, there are a hadith about jihad. You're going to learn the tajweed of the Quran, the tafsir of the Quran. You're going to come across ayat about jihad. I say, let us learn jihad the correct way. Let us educate the people about jihad the correct way. Put it in its context, explain. There's people, places, times. There's the context. As for running away, we can't run away. Because in our talk today, what are some of the causes of weakness of the ummah? Leaving off jihad. What jihad? The jihad of al-Islam. The jihad in which the kalim of Allah is uppermost. The jihad what? Has been it has been legislated so that Allah will be worshipped. Not this craziness. Not the craziness. And Allah will leave us in that condition until we come back. As a side issue, 20 years ago, 25 years ago, Al-Albani rahmatullahi alayhi, Imam Al-Albani, he had a mashru', he had a project. He called his project the project of At-Tasfiyah wa Tarbiyah. At-Tasfiyah wa Tarbiyah. This hadith right here is one of those hadith he used to mention all the time to the students and the people who used to listen to him. This issue about what is the condition of the Muslims today? The condition of the Muslims is weak because, and this is one of the issues he used to mention all the time, a repetitive hadith that deserves a khutbah to it, deserves a lesson about it, just the fiqh of the hadith. So that's number two, al-jihad. A lot can be said about that, but again, time is rolling, so we're going to move to the third point, inshallah ta'ala. Number three is what is really important as well, what would cause weakness. And I'm bringing this particular thing out because of something that I know someone close to me suffers from. And I would think that we have people in our community who suffer from it as well, because it's a kind of mental illness. When I say mental illness, I'm not putting a person down and I'm not saying they're schizophrenic. But one of the signs of Yom Kiyamah is the spread of mental illness. There's a high portion of the population, they suffer from mental illnesses, some extremely severe and some not so severe. But one of the things that will cause weakness to the individual is something that happened to a companion until he heard the instructions of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His kunya is Abu Qatada. Abu Qatada said, I used to have dreams. And when I had those dreams, they would make me sick from thinking about them, overthinking. So I would see something in my dream and it would be so vivid, it would be so disturbing, that when I wake up, I would keep thinking about that dream and I became physically sick. Developed ulcers, the person's stomach, it comes out because they have anxiety, they have to take medication because they're overthinking. He said, so I complained to the Prophet about my problem, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that I would become sick from a dream, a dream. The Nabi told them, and he told the companions as well, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, radiyallahu anhum, al-ru'ya as-salihatu min Allahi, wa ru'ya as-su' min ash-shaytan. فَإِذَا رَأَ أَحَدُكُمْ مَا يُحِبُّ فَلَا يُحَدِّثُ إِلَّا فَلَا يُحَدِّثُ بِهَا إِلَّا مَنْ يُحِبُّ وَإِذَا رَأَ أَحَدُكُمْ مَا يَكْرُهُ فَلْيَلْتَفِلْ عَنْ يَسَارِهِ ثَلَاثٍ وَلْيَتَعَوِّذْ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ وَشَرِّهَا فَإِنَّهَا لَنْ تَضُرُّهُ. He told that companion and the rest of the people, he said that the good dreams that you people have, the good dreams, it is from Allah. When you see a good dream, it's from Allah. He said that the bad dream, the nightmare, the things that make you upset, the things that cause you to be a bit off key, he said that's from the shaitan. He said if any of you sees a good dream that he likes, then don't talk about that dream except to someone that he loves. The same advice that Yaqub gave to his son Yusuf. When Yusuf said to his father, Ya abati inni ra'aytu ahada ashara kawkaban wa shamsa wal qamar ra'aytuhum li sajidin. I saw 11 stars, the sun and the moon making sajda to me. His father said, don't tell your brothers about this dream, because they're going to have hasad against you. They're going to be envious and stuff, jealous. Tell people who have your best interests at heart. Don't tell anybody who you're in doubt about whether or not they have your best interests at heart. He says, so if you see in a good dream, only tell those who you love. But if you see a bad dream, he told the people, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, turn to your left, spit 3 times. Also seek refuge in Allah while you're lying there from the evil of a shaitan and from the evil of the dream. And then he said, for verily the dream, it can't hurt you. The dream can't hurt you. The thing that you're overthinking about, it can't hurt you, can't harm you. We take from that hadith what the scholar of Islam told the people who suffer from hum wal gham. People who have anxiety, hum wal gham, they got worries. And because of that anxiety and that worry, the individual overthinks, and as a result of overthinking, the quality of his life or her life is affected adversely. They suffer from irritable bowel thing. What is it called? Irritable bowel syndrome. Well, that's where he can't hold himself. He has to go to the toilet all the time. Over what? He ate something bad? No. His nerves are just jammed up. So overthinking and being an individual who worries about things unnecessarily. The person is worrying, am I a good mother? And because they're worrying whether or not they're a good mother, they become paralyzed and can't do anything by just going over in their mind. Am I a good mother? Am I a good mother? as opposed to doing the best they could possibly do, live their life, and let the chips fall the way they may, and do those things that the religion told you to do, like memorize the dua of anxiety and worries. So overthinking too much will cause weakness, as it happened to that companion, Abu Qatada, radiallahu anhu, wa sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. Another issue, ikhwani, and as I mentioned, there are many, and this is critical, because it's so basic and fundamental, especially in the environment that we're living in right now, and the challenges that we have. But as I told you, mental illnesses are on the rise, and they are muntasha, because we have to say our behavior is the behavior of crazy people. One of the things that clearly causes weaknesses is al-ikhtilaf and al-tafarruq. Al-ikhtilaf and al-tafarruq. I look in this audience, and there are a lot of faces that I know from way back in the day, and there are faces that I know from the recent times. And those people, I say, what is it that allowed most of us, if not all of us, to remain together? And I don't agree with everything that they think they think and believe in fiqh. I'm praying between two people, and both of them are moving their fingers like that, and I don't move my finger. And there are many issues like that. That one comes up from Rukur, and the Imam says, Sami Allah liman hamida. And the one on my right said, Sami Allah liman hamida. And the other one said, Rabbana lakal hamd. So these fiqh issues, they're ikhtilaf. We're not going to fight over those issues. Whereas there are other people from the same dawah that we're on who their religion is getting close to Allah by hating us. Salafis hating each other. Some of these young brothers, like two of the brothers I came here with, I asked the brother, how long have you been on the dawah? He said, 5 years, 6 years. How did you come to the dawah? He said, here, Guraba, I came out of dawah. I said, you missed it 15, 20 years ago. The brotherhood of the dawah back then. Now the young man comes to the dawah, the young lady comes to the dawah right now, and she hates, and he hates, I mean hate, people who preceded them from the du'at, from the regular people who are just regular Muslims who are just older than them. They hate you. They won't even allow you, the brother won't allow his other brother to go to Green Lane Masjid wearing his socks. He said, no, those are my socks. You can't go to Green Lane Masjid with my socks. Take my socks off and give me my socks. I don't want my socks in the Masjid of Mubtadiya. No, ikhwani, this is the sickness. Now, that ikhtilaf and that tafarruq, it causes weakness. It causes the da'wah of Salafiyya to be weak. 15 years ago, 20 years ago, a Salafiyya was spreading like wildfire, if I can use that example, all over this country, all over the world, Africa, all over the world. It was spreading. And then the enemies of a Salafiyya from outside and from within, they came and they started doing things. And now we have a situation that is confused right now. It's confused. And ikhtilaf is a problem. The ikhtilaf that we have today. Allah mentioned in the Quran, وَعَتِيُوا اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ وَلَا تَنَازَعُوا فَتَفْشَلُوا وَتَذْهَبَ رِيحُكُمْ وَاصْبِرُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ. He said, obey Allah and obey His Messenger unconditionally. Obey Allah, obey His Messenger unconditionally. وَلَا تَنَازَعُوا. And don't fight amongst yourselves. Don't be those people who are fighting over the dunya and issues. فَتَفْشَلُوا. Because if you fight, you're going to be fashioning. You're going to lose your situation. And your power is going to go. Your might, your ability. Allah called it your rih. You know, the rih is the air. Your power is going to go. And be patient. Be patient with each other. For verily, Allah Azza wa Jalla, He loves those who are patient. So concerning this issue of at-tafarruq and ikhtilaf, it can come in many shapes, it can come in many forms. For an example, some people are racist because, some people we have ikhtilaf because of racism. We have ikhtilaf because of racism. That's a problem, that'll make you weak. Some people, they had ikhtilaf because the madhhabiyya, that's Shafi, that's Ahmed, this is that, that, because of that. Some people have racism because they have ikhtilaf, different issues. Whatever the issue happens to be, at-tafarruq and al-ikhtilaf, it leads to weakness. It is an evil thing. And that's why those scholars of Islam, ikhwani, in the past, they used to write those books about how to have the etiquette of ikhtilaf. Because this group of Muslims who are in this room right now, if we were to travel to Hajj, if we were to travel, we chose the Imam who led us in Salah, he's going to be the Imam. On the way to Hajj and back, we are not all going to agree with him, and we're not going to agree with each other. It's just not going to happen. It's not possible. It's not possible. So when we disagree, how do we behave? And what do we do? So those ulama of Islam, they brought that particular issue to the attention of the community so as to do what? So as to do and to take those lessons that we saw with the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who had every reason to be mukhtalifin between themselves, but they discarded all of those issues. They had some challenges along the way, and if they had challenges, we're gonna have challenges. They had challenges along the way. The Ansar and the Muhajireen, and almost some problems with the tribe. Some people even got killed. But never, ever, ever did it destroy the community. Those people who were on the mountain, 70 people, the archers, and they ran off of the mountain. That ikhtilaf there caused some problems, but it didn't destroy the community. It didn't destroy the dawah. It made a setback, but it didn't destroy the community. It didn't destroy the dawah. An ikhtilaf is a big mushkila. Those of you who are writing, I want to bring your attention to an ayah of the Quran. You go back, you deal with this ayah, you look at this ayah. In Surah Ash-Shura, Ash-Shura is ayat number 13 and 14. Allah Ta'ala mentioned in the second ayah, we'll only deal with that for right now. وَمَا تَفَرَّقُوا إِلَّا مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَهُمُ الْعِلْمُ بَغْيًا بَيْنَهُمْ. Allah said about Bani Israel that they did not divide amongst themselves except after knowledge came to them and they had this baghy, they had this oppression that was there. So as a result of that, they became divided. This is extremely important. وَمَا تَفَرَّقُوا. They did not have this ikhtilaf and this breaking up except after the knowledge came to them and they had baghy. Goes to show us, Wani, if people have knowledge, like Salafi people have knowledge, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, as we mentioned many times here and we heard many times, Ahlul Sunnah, they're the most knowledgeable people about Allah, and they're the most merciful people towards the creation. They know the Khaliq better than everybody else. All of those other groups, they may have ulama with them, they may have some gifted people, but generally speaking, the people of the Sunnah are going to have more knowledge than other people. The ulama of the Sunnah will have more knowledge than the ulama of the other people. The regular Amr Bakr Zayd from Ahlul Sunnah, he's going to have more knowledge than the regular Amr Bakr Zayd from these different groups. This is how it is. Sometimes you'll have someone from that group who have more knowledge, but generally speaking, it's what we just said. So people of the Salafi, they have knowledge about Allah's names and His attributes, about many fiqh principles, about many names, about many ahadith. They have knowledge about many things. But when you have knowledge and you have oppression, you have baghy and knowledge, there's going to be a tafarruq. When you have knowledge, knowledge is there, some is there. But with that knowledge is oppression, there's going to be a tafarruq. Again, like Yusuf and his brothers. Yusuf's brothers, salawatullahi wasalam wa alayhim ajma'in. Yusuf's brothers later on, as the scholars of Islam said, they became prophets. They became prophets. The ones who wanted to kill him and throw him into the well, they were not prophets at that time, but they became prophets later on. And they made Tawbah later on. And the proof that they made Toba is their dream. They made sejda to Yusuf, recognizing who he was. So they made Toba, and it's established in the Quran that they became prophets later on. But before they became prophets, they wanted to get rid of Yusuf. This is not Yusuf, but they wanted to get him off of the scene. They didn't want him on the scene. And this is what we have, oppression. A person, he has some knowledge, but they go to the leader, and they lie on the scholar like Ibn Taymiyyah, and they made up all of those lies about him, so he got put in prison. He went to prison for stuff he didn't even do. But why did they do that? They did that because that's how it is. Whenever you have knowledge and you have oppression, it's going to lead to that. Those people wanted to get rid of Yusuf. We have that same issue today. Why are we upset with each other? And why are we so intolerant of each other? Why is this stuff going on? People just want everybody who they see as being in opposition off of the playing field. So it's just them, their sheikhs, and their way. So knowledge along with oppression, it leads to ikhtilaf. It leads to a tafarruq. And ikhtilaf and a tafarruq, it leads to weakness within the community. Number five, number six, whatever number we're on, inshallah, is seeking honor, izzah from other than the proper sources will make you weak. Seeking honor and izzah from other than the proper place. And I'm saying this without biting my tongue, because today we have a lot of experts in al-Islam who speak on behalf of Islam, but in reality they're enemies to Islam. When they speak on programs like The Big Question, when they come on these programs, what do Muslims really want? What do British Muslims really want? As I mentioned, I have to know who did you ask that question? Those thousand Muslims, who did you ask? Because their answers are not going to be indicative of what our answers would be. They came in here and asked 1,000 people in this masjid, however many people, and they started asking you, do you want to send your school, your kids to a Muslim school? Everybody's going to say, yeah, but I can't afford it. But if I could, I would do it. Do you want to live on a street where there's only Muslims? It's going to say, yeah, I would like to do something like that. What about you over there? Would you like to see the Sharia being established? Yeah, I would love to see the Sharia being established. Everybody's going to give those same answers. How do you feel about homosexuality? Homosexuality is a major sin. It's a major crime in Islam. Those are our answers. But those answers that we're given, you shouldn't understand from those answers that we're saying homosexuality is against our religion, but that doesn't mean I'm trying to kill homosexuals. I want my children to go to a Muslim school and live on a street that's all Muslims, but that doesn't mean that I want to be isolated from the outer community. I'm not saying that. If you ask anyone in this country, do you want to live on the street and you have a bunch of Romanians and they are your neighbors? I'm not against Romanians. And I'm not being stereotypical. But who's going to say, yeah, bring those Romanians. I want them all living my cup. He's going to say, no. I want to live with people who are similar to me. But that doesn't mean I'm a racist. It doesn't mean I'm an extremist. It doesn't mean, and on and on and on and on. So we have these people, and we don't want our children to be like that. And we don't want ourselves to be like that. We on TV and on radio representing Islam or the balanced view. We don't want people to misconstrue what is the right position, the correct position. Don't look for izzah, don't look for validation from outside of the religion, because when you do that, there's a price to pay. Don't be apologetic, because when you do that, there's a price to pay. And part of the price to pay is weakness, based upon the kitab and based upon the sunnah. And there are many examples. I give you the famous example. The example of what happened with Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu when he left al-Medina and he traveled all the way to Bayt al-Maqdis. He traveled all the way to Bayt al-Maqdis to make the istilam of the miftah. He's going to get the key from the Ahlul Kitab, showing Muslims are now in charge of Jerusalem. He rode all the way from Medina And with him was a khadam, not a slave, a khadam, someone who was there to serve him. They came with one animal on that journey. Umar would ride, and the other one would walk. The other one would ride, Umar would walk. Ride, walk, ride, walk. It just happened based upon the qadr when he arrived in the eyesight of the people of Jerusalem. Umar was walking, and the other man was on the horse. Abu Ubaidah ibn Jarrah, one of the 10 people promised Jannah, one from the best of the companions. He left the people he's with them. They're seeing Umar came. He got on this thing. He rode out there real quick. He said, hey, hey, Amir al-Mu'mineen, Amir al-Mu'mineen, don't come in walking like that, barefooted with your shoes on, your thing like that. Don't come in here walking like that. You get on the horse and you ride through. And that statement of Abu Ubaidah, it had his position in the Kitab and the Sunnah. He wasn't apologetic. But what he's trying to do is get Umar to realize, hey, we want these people to know who you are and who we are. Umar understood that as well. There was a Muslim during the time of Umar. He was walking down the street, and that guy was walking with his back down like this and his head like that. Like he's real miskeen and real pious, zahid, abid. Umar hit him on his shoulder with a stick and said, hey, don't walk like that. You want these people to think that, you know, you can just come and chump the Muslims off? Can't walk like that. You're existing like that. Everybody who sees you, you're going to challenge you. So Umar knew that. Don't walk like that. The Nabi made Hajj, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, make the tawaf around the Kaaba. He heard that the Kufar of Quraysh were saying, the Muslims are sick, the Muslims are sick. Maybe we can make a last-ditch effort. We can get them. Prophet Muhammad heard that. He said, okay, everybody expose your right arm and put your ihram under your muscle and make your muscle get bigger, and we're going to run around the Kaaba the first 3 times. When the non-Muslims saw that, they said, well, we're not going to try to deal with them. Them people are not sick. Look at their muscles. And plus, so the Nabi, he knows that. He knows the psychology of the people. Abu Dujana, one of those strong Muslims, one of those strong, equipped mujahideen from the Prophet's companions. After the Muslims had a fight, they engaged the non-Muslims, and they took a time out. They took a break. You go get yourself, get some rest, and we don't get some rest. Abu Dujana got on his horse, and he started making his horse prance the way horses do in the horse show, where they make the horse, you know, walk in a particular way. Something that the Arabs used to do. He did that in front of the people to get the people excited. To say to the people laying down, hey, this is not the time to lay down. Let's go and deal with them people. When the Prophet saw that, and that prancing of the horse is kibr, it's arrogance. That's an arrogant walk. He said, if it wasn't for this jihad, this mishya is not permissible at any time other than right here. So the Nabi, he knows the importance of the visuals that people receive about other people. So when Umar was approached by Abu Ubaidah, may Allah be pleased with both of them, he said, come, Amir al-Mu'mineen, get on your horse, put your shoes on and drive through. He said, I wish someone other than you would have come and told me that, yeah, Abu Ubaidah. You? One of the 10 people promised Jannah? Why couldn't it be some new Muslim or some Bedouin from the desert? But you? He said, wallahi, we, the Arabs, we were a people, yarhamakullah. We were a people before Islam. We were a people who were down, low, weak, downtrodden, underfoot. Persians, Romans, they didn't even consider us. When the messenger of Allah would go to the Persian leader, they would say to him, hey, you stink. Don't come inside of our majlis like that. Go and bathe before we listen to you and your letter. He didn't even want to look at him. Say, you stink. Look at your clothes. And that companion would say, hey, as you like. But I have the letter right here, and I'm coming from a group of people I left. They love death more than you love life. I think you better listen and you better read. And then the man took him and he read it. Because what kind of answer? Okay, he may look that way to you, but that ain't the kalam of a hobo. That's not a kalam of a bum. That's not a kalam of an individual who is miscreant. That's a man who's aziz and he has izzah to say that like that. And his clothes are like that? Anyway, Umar told that man, told Abu Ubaidah, describing their condition. We used to be like this, we used to be like that. And then Allah honored us with al-Islam. Anytime we seek to get honor in other than al-Islam, Allah is going to put us down. Anytime you seek to get honor in other than al-Islam, وَمَنْ كَانَ يُرِيدُ الْعِزَّةَ فَلِلَّهِ الْعِزَّةُ جَمِيعًا. Anybody wants izzah, izzah belongs to Allah. So the Muslim lady, for an example, she wants to be a feminist. The rights of the Muslim lady is not in feminism. The Muslim professional, any, whatever. We don't look politics, whatever. We don't look for anything outside of this religion to give us strength. According to the statement of Umar radiallahu anhu, anyone who does that, then the end result of that is you're going to be put down. The last point we want to make is 20, because Salat, the adhan is supposed to be at this time. But let me finish this off. And this was the main point that the brother was telling me about. Why did they name this thing? One of the causes of weakness, the biggest, most critical, most serious cause of weakness, is what we get in the hadith. Hussein, Imran ibn Hussein, may Allah be pleased with him, he said that a man came in to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he had on his arm a talisman, a ta'weeb, a tamima. He had his arm, a talisman. It was like yellow, gold in the way it looked. Rasulullah, not knowing the ilm al-ghayb, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not being hazir, nazir, he said to the man, what is that? He didn't know. He said, what is that? What's that on your arm? The man said, al-wahina ya Rasulullah. Al-wahina means it's to protect me from that disease you get in your lungs. Pleurism. Something like that. That disease. It's like pneumonia. You're getting your throat in your lungs, what they used to get in the Arabian Peninsula. The Prophet told that man, according to that hadith, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in Zaha, فَإِنَّهَا لَا تَزِيدُكَ إِلَّا وَهْنٍ وَلَوْ مِتَّ وَهِيَ عَلَيْكَ مَا أَفْلَحْتَ أَبَدًا. وَفِي رِوَايَةٍ مِتَّ عَلَى غَيْرِ أُمَّتِ مُحَمَّدٍ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, take that thing off. Take it off. Because that thing is not going to do anything except increase you in weakness. It's going to increase you in weakness. And if you die and that thing is on your arm, it won't benefit you at all. Another narration said, if you die and it's on your arm, you'll die on other than the millah, other than the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Shaykh al-Islam Muhammad ibn Abu Wahab, he brought this hadith, Ikhwani, brought this hadith in the book, Kitab al-Tawheed, in the chapter of the impermissibility of the tama'im. He said after bringing this hadith, Al-Imam Ahmed collected it and his isnad is jayyid. There are some problems with that hadith by itself. But there are other hadith that come in that same chapter and other hadith outside of that chapter that strengthen the hadith, the meaning of the hadith, and so forth and so on. And some of the ulama, the opinion, the hadith is authentic. So the point here is, this man was looking for strength and protection, and what? Bring shirk to the table and kufr to the table. So from what will cause weakness is for a person to have anything in his mind, anything in his existence that is shirkun billahi. Whether he realizes it or he doesn't realize it. And we're living in a society where shirk creeps up on us and with us. As we were coming over here, there's a new song out. And I gotta mention this so you understand what I'm saying if you didn't know. That famous song by this lady, her name is Adele. It's called Hello. The Muslim always has to do everything that non-Muslims do. You know the happy song. Happy, you gotta be happy. Okay, we gotta make our happy song as well. Okay, Adele made a song. Hello, big song, blew up. Now the Muslim man, Asian brother, he comes and he sings his version of Hello. And instead of saying hello, he says Allah, and he puts some kalam in there. As if he's in love with Allah, like they have some romantic relationship. And if you listen to the song is kufr. Now, look at the comments of the young Muslims. The women and other than that, our youngsters, teenagers, who have no minhaj. They don't know the religion. Because the song is popular, it sounds good. Just like happy Muslims. You put that on, you may tap your feet, you may bump your head a little bit because the sound of the song. But does that mean that thing is okay? In this case, Allah, you are having a romantic discussion, and the people who listen to that, like it, comment, kufrun billahi, in many shape, forms of fashion. Just the society that we live in, it's like that. So with that being the case, the Muslim has to be on top of making sure he pushes out and away from himself anything that remotely resembles a shirk or kufr. And there are many things in what we say and in what we do and how we exist. Watching certain programs and being committed to watching those programs, that the meaning of which, magic, all of those issues, those things cause a disconnect from Allah Azza wa Jalla. We're going to stop here, inshallah, Allah Azza wa Jalla, and perform the Salat of Al-Isha bi idhnillahi ta'ala. Anything that we said that was right and exact, ikhwani, that's from Allah wahdahu la sharika la. Anything that was said that was incorrect and inappropriate, that's from me and Shaytan Allah. It's meant to have nothing to do with it. When I mention those things about Adele and things like that, it's not to make those people popular, but it's because we have youngsters out there, they know what I'm talking about. Our elders may not know. Our elders still, they don't even know what Facebook is. They don't know what Skype, IMO, they don't even know what that is. And we don't blame them about that. But as I told you, we got a lot of challenges that are on the table. A lot of challenges. And we're the last group of people in this community here, in this country, who we remain a people who don't have a clue as to many of the contemporary challenges that are facing our community. Ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to help this community, inshallah, divinely protect you brothers and make you guys from the Ansar of the Sunnah Muhammadiyah, and that Allah Ta'ala gives you guys strength to continue to push the Sunnah forward in a moderate, modest, correct way. And he's capable of that. Hada wa sallallahu wa sallam wa barak ala nabiyyina wa ala alihi wa ashabi ajma'in. Alhamdulillahi wa salatu wa salam ala Rasulullah. The brother's asking about the hadith that we discussed concerning turning towards the dunya and abandoning jihad in the cause of Allah. And if we were to do that, then it would be a cause of weakness and loneliness. So he wants to know, which jihad is that talking about? Because people of the sunnah, the correct way in al-Islam and understanding of jihad is that jihad is just not with the tunnel vision that some people have, where it's just spilling blood, has no goals, has no objectives, doesn't have any benefits, doesn't have any consideration concerning, it doesn't have any context. So is that hadith talking about the jihad of taking the fight to the enemy, or the jihad where the Muslims are protecting themselves when people come to them? What comes to the mind of the hadith is that it's talking about the jihad of going forward. But he used the general word, and in order to make it specific, there has to be some type of proof that's going to come to us, either from the hadith itself or other texts, to indicate it's something else. So it can be both, because if people are having the jihad of protection, all right, they're doing the dunya and all of that, and the enemy comes to do something to them, they don't do anything about that, and that in and of itself is loneliness. In and of itself is loneliness. Also, if they turn to the dunya and so forth and so on, and they're not going out to spread the religion and so forth and so on, then the end result of that is going to be loneliness. So it's both ways, and Allah knows best. Fadl Yahi, Shaheed, Shadeed, Shaheed. And no doubt there are different people when it comes to getting knowledge and putting that knowledge out. People are in different levels. Some people learn to be able to beat people up. Some people learn in order for the fingers to point to them. Some people learn in order to test people, like the ulama, to show how smart he is and how unintelligent the scholar is. Some people learn just to argue. The Prophet described the people, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who this is their description. He said, the fire is more befitting for them. It's a sign of lack of sincerity. So the person's goal and the objective is to learn knowledge, to push ignorance off of himself, so that he can worship Allah with clarity, knowing what he has to do. That's the goal and the objective. And the other challenges that come along the way, refuting, explaining, and all of that stuff, that is secondary. So the goal and the objective is not to learn to beat people up, to get information, to be able to say, I have this to beat people up. And this is a disease that we are witnessing right now. Al-Imam Al-Albani, rahmatullahi alayhi, in one of the sittings that he had with a group of people who came to him with this stuff, he said, I see you young people who are doing this. He said, I see you on a way that's astray, in a way that's an innovation. Going and fishing for people's mistakes in murky waters just to be refuted everyone. He said, this thing does nothing except causes hatred to be in the hearts from both sides, the ones who are doing it and the ones who it is being done to. So the advice is for us to be serious and honest with ourselves. Sufyan al-Thawri is one of the 10 ulama of al-hadith who's considered to be Amir al-Mu'mineen in al-hadith. He said, I never had a jihad that I struggled with more than having ikhlas when it came to knowledge. That's Sufyan al-Thawri. So today, regular Amr Bakr and Zayd person finds himself in a situation where people are looking at him and listening to him and things like that. It becomes very easy for regular people today to use the religion in order to get some type of validation. So my advice is, keep it simple. Try to learn this religion for yourself and for your family as well. And learn the religion in order to give da'wah Allah, but don't make that be necessarily your main goal and objective. Let your goal and objective be, I'm going to learn this religion, inshallah, for my own self and those people around me. And then if that other stuff comes, let the chips fall where they may. But we're living in a time where, unfortunately, with the social media, any and everybody can become famous or somebody just being a keyboard warrior behind and saying everything they want to say about the religion. So just keep it simple and make jihad against that issue. For the no doubt avoiding questions is part of the fiqh. Those ulama of the past from the Salaf, they said, if you see a person answering every single question, then you should know that he's majnoon. Because he doesn't know everything, first of all. And second of all, the question can be a loaded question. Third of all, there are certain questions that you may be confronted with. It's not for this majlis. For every place, there's a time and a place for everything. And that's what we found, starting with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Someone came to the door, they knocked on the door. He said to that individual, let him in, go let him in. When he came in, he told him the virtues of La ilaha illallah. You say La ilaha illallah, you're going to go to Jannah. The person said, should I not go and tell the people, Ya Rasulullah, that if they say La ilaha illallah, they're going to go to Jannah? He said, no, don't tell them, because they just may rely on that. Do we call that hiding knowledge from the Prophet? He was hiding knowledge? Of course not. And he, other than that occasion, told people the virtues of La ilaha illallah. He said the same thing. But that particular man, he said, don't go and tell him that. And we find that with those companions as well. A number of them, Abu Huraira, he told the people, if I were to tell you everything that I know from the Sunnah, they're going to chop my neck off. And Hajjaj ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi. The destruction of this deen is going to be at the hands of some young people of Quraysh. Now, if I started telling you all of these hadith and I started giving the names, I'm going to get my neck chopped off. So he held it back because he doesn't want to get his neck chopped off. So to answer every single question is from fiqh to weigh the situation. What's going to be the impact? Who's listening to you? Ali, Abdullah, Ibn Mas'ud. They both said basically the same thing. Talk to the people in accordance to the level of their understanding. Do you want them to reject Allah and His Messenger? You never talk to a people and you use speech that doesn't reach, it goes beyond the intellect, that what you say is going to be a fitna for some of them. So you can't say any and everything at any and every sitting and assembly. You have to look, who are you dealing with and what's going on? So there's fiqh in asking questions and there's fiqh in answering the questions, because people try to set you up as well. There's just certain things you shouldn't say just because you're not from this community. So I came in this community, someone asked me a question and I gave that answer, then I get up, I left. And then it created prop. I didn't come here for that. So why did I answer the question? So may Allah protect us. Any more questions, ikhwan? Tafadhal. I think what you're saying is someone believes he should do this thing this particular way, like say Ameen. But he may go to a masjid where they don't say Ameen. So he doesn't say Ameen, so he doesn't make problems. So he knows and he feels something is the right way to do it. But because of the environment, he's not going to do that thing in order to make problems. He don't want to make problems. It's permissible in our religion. But you have to look at what it is that you're doing. As the Imam, Abu Salam, the Imam. People invite me and they come, they say, okay, you do the khutbah, you're the khatib, the imam. Okay, I want to show the people the different ways of doing the taslim. Now, I got to look at this masjid, Masjid al-Ghuraba. Generally speaking, this is the masjid of the sunnah. People are students here. We've been at this for a number of years, chiseling at this situation. So if something were to be done that some people didn't know about, the cultivation of the people in this masjid is, he's going to come to me and say, well, what's that all about? Or someone's going to come and then we can deal with it. But I go to a masjid, those people don't know anything about anything. Why am I going to do that to slam and say, salamu alaikum, and that's it? I'm going to make that strange and then make the people hate the sunnah. Like the Prophet says, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from you are people who run the other people away. From you are those people who run people away. You make tanfir. The people are not ready for that. I prayed in Green Lane, Alul Hadith, Green Lane Masjid, 7, 8, 9 years ago when I first went there. I made one taslim. People, the elders came and said, well, what are you doing? But those elders were people who didn't know as-salafiyya and Ahlul Hadith, those words are synonyms. They didn't know that they were kalimatan, mutaradifatan. As-salafiyya, al-hadith means the same thing. One of them said, those salafis trying to take over our masjid. Yo, Ahlul Hadith, salafi is the same thing. So when you're dealing with people like that, the people, the environment, you got to look at all of those issues because it's wajib, wajib. Keep the Muslims united, keep the Muslims together. And it's the sunnah to do this and to do that. But the fiqh experience helps you to know I'm going to implement this thing and I'm going to implement that thing because I know the people. Those people, they trust you. So if you do something, it's not a problem. I go into a Somali masjid in Canada, in America, majority of people Somali. I'm not going to start talking about the dynamics of the problems with the tribalism. I'm not going to open up that topic. Start talking about Hawi and Darud and I'm not going to talk about that because that's not my territory. That's not my business. That thing is bigger than me. Let their shuyukh, who they know, they know him, let them talk about that. So there's a time and a place for everything. So if you're going to leave something from the sunnah in order to make the tahqiq of something that is more beneficial, permissible, then the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he didn't write Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. When the Kufa of Quraysh had a problem with ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, he took it off. This letter is between Muhammad Rasulullah Quraysh. They said, we thought you were Rasulullah, we want to fight you. He said, Ali, erase that thing. And he's really Rasulullah. Because it's not really about that. The thing is about the bigger picture, man, get the program moving. But it requires fiqh. So that we're not from the two extremes. The one who's going to blow up the spot no matter what, at all costs. He's a problem. And then the other one who'll be dancing, shucking and jiving and apologizing. And both of them are a problem. The real rough one is a problem. And that other guy is a problem as well. I don't know which one I dislike the most. I don't know which one. At least the rough one, there's some manliness there. But rough and tough is not okay. That's for that guy over there. That guy over there, these people come on these programs, Quilliam Foundation, these people like this. These people are a problem. Any more questions, Ikhwan? Father Yahi Shaheed, these last two questions and then we're out of here. we do it in Greenlee Masjid on Wednesday night. We're reading a book by Imam al-Tirmidhi called Shama'il al-Muhammadiyah. And Imam al-Tirmidhi wrote this book, Rahmatullahi Alayhi, in which he told the community everything you need to know about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, what he wore, what he ate, how he slept, how he walked, the clothes that belonged to him. One of the wisdoms and reasons that we chose this particular book was we wanted to reconnect the community, the Salafi people, and other than them, to the Nabi of al-Islam, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and not Sheikh Fulan or Sheikh Alan. We respect our ulama, but this innovation of 1, 2, 3 sheikhs, and that's it, and the dalil is what the sheikh says, and the sheikh is ma'soom, and he talks, hey man, what kind of Salafi is that? What kind of Islam is that? You people have gone backwards. So we wanted our community to know what our Nabi was, so that you can see. That's why Imam al-Tirmidhi wrote that book, Rahmatullahi Alayhi. And we mentioned in most of the chapters, many of the chapters, that we don't encourage anybody here to wear an izar and to go out in public with an izar. We don't encourage anybody here to do those practices that the Prophet used to do, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if the people in our environment are not doing those practices. And it's going to change from place to place and time to time. In Saudi Arabia, in Medina and Mecca, the Muslims over there, they wear thobes. The Prophet's thobe, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was halfway to his shin, halfway. That's the izar al-mu'min. That's where the thobe should be, the best place. But in Medina and Mecca, if you wear your thobe there, the people there may look at you and they may say, my son is becoming an irhabi. My son is being mujashaddid. They're not wearing those clothes. So therefore, you shouldn't wear those clothes. You shouldn't wear your thobe to that point. And there, Medina Mecca, they wear the shema. You know what I mean? If you put on your head the imam of the Nabi, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and you put it around your neck, and you make it muhannika, the people are going to say, what you think, you Mauritanian, something like that? So in that case, don't do it. Because you're going to make yourself look gharib and ajeeb. And that's not what the da'i does. To the best of his ability, he tries to fit in with the people. Because this is what Allah has sent all of those people. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا بِلِسَانِ قَوْمِهِ Sent those prophets. Talk in the language of those people. Being like those people. So similarly, when a person wants to do something that the Prophet did, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we gotta make a distinction. The sunnah to the muhaddithin is anything and everything that he did. So the fact that he liked the shoulder, it's the sunnah to like the shoulder of the meat, that's what he did. But the people of Usul, that's not the understanding. And we don't say you have to like the shoulder, eat the shoulder. We don't say that. But if you do, do that because you wanted to get rewarded, you will get rewarded. Because that's what some of the companions did. They ate things just because he ate them, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. From vegetables and other than that. They said, I don't have anything to do with this. It's just that he did it, so I did. The Dawab ibn Umar used to make his animal do everything that the Prophet's animal did, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And his father told him, hey, people are looking at you. You like an imam. People follow you. If you do this, you make the religion difficult for sin. So Umar didn't allow him. He didn't say to his son that we don't like the sunnah, but the people are following you. You make the religion. So within yourself, no problem. Within the people who you have supervision over, no problem. But to put that on the people, to put that on the community, la. There's a difference between being ghuraba, you know, people, and the difference between the people who are just being strange. You got the strangers, and then you got the people who are strange with what they're saying and what they're doing. Okay, Ikhwani, we're going to start. Oh, my man, it's the last one right here.
Is that all that change that I'm trying to do?
hadith, I don't remember how it started, but I don't remember it said anything about the takbir. What comes to my mind is that before he starts the recitation, for some reason that's in my mind, that he has to get there before the imam finishes the dua al-istiftah. So if someone is sitting here right now with a smartphone and you can get that hadith very quickly so that we can get the nas of the hadith. That's number one. As for the second part of the question, what if the individual, for some reason, he reaches 20 days, 25 days, 30 days, and then something comes up where his job and his lifestyle, he could have gotten that hadith, but something came up that prevented it and it was beyond his ability. Then we have to know that our Lord is Kareem. Our Lord is Kareem. And Allah Ta'ala rewards people for what they do based upon their niyyah. So if an individual was used to praying in the masjid, but he became sick. So he didn't come to the masjid, he's going to get the reward of praying in that masjid. Individuals used to praying standing up, and he became sick, so he started praying sitting down. He's going to get the reward of praying sitting down. That individual, he was on his way to do that thing beyond his ability. Something happened, now he can't come. Allah Ta'ala, he is generous. He gives people beyond what they ask for. He is Jawad, and he loves Jude. He's not stingy, he's not oppressive. So if this was his situation, then inshallah, it's no problem if it's beyond his ability. Let me just see this hadith real quick. The imam gets it, of course, because he fixed the hadith. And as we said earlier, if someone is going to exclude people or include people, or people are going to give conditions to a particular hadith, or they got to make it special, they got to make it... No, we have principles that we have to work by. The Nabi's kalam was general, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You don't make it specific without any dalil. And if something is specific, you don't make it general without any dalil. So that kalam is general with that imam. But let me see what this hadith said right here. Whoever prays 40 prayers in my mosque, missing no prayer. It's just a general hadith. Anyone who prays 40 prayers in a masjid. But the Muslims, they go to Medina and they, for some reason, think I gotta get 40 prayers in the Prophet's masjid. And if you did it in his masjid, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it's even better, but you could do that right here in Masjid al-Ghuraba. You could do that right here in this masjid. Get 40 prayers behind the imam. So the issue is that takbir. I don't remember about the takbir. I don't remember. It said takbir. Where that's at, man? Okay. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, whoever prays for 40 days with the congregation, always being present for the first takbir, it will be written that he will be safe from two things. He will be safe from the fire and safe from hypocrisy. May Allah protect us from the nar of Jahannam and from al-nifaq. This hadith has been classed as hasan by al-Albani and Sahih al-Tirmidhi. The answer, the person said, the virtue mentioned in this hadith is general and it applies to any mosque with prayers are offered in congregation in any land. It does not apply only to a Masjid al-Haram in Mecca or Masjid al-Nabawi in Medina in particular. Based on this, whoever consistently prays 40 days in congregation which he is present for the first takbir, it will be recorded that he will be safe from two things, safe from the fire and safe from the hypocrisy, whether the mosque is in Medina, Mecca, or anywhere. So it is the takbir. What's your name? Shari. Okay, Masjid Al-Ghuraba. May Allah protect you, brothers, inshallah, your administration, your imam, your children, your families, inshallah. Stick together, be united on the kitab and the sunnah. Let the sunnah go forth and don't stop it with your opinions. And may Allah keep you guys balanced on the Sirat al-Mustaqim. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك واشهد ان لا اله الا انت استغفرك واتوب اليك السلام عليكم ورحمه الله وبركاته